couldn't ever think of going all the way to Himalaya just to carry on repeating what other climbers did in the past. Just seems like a complete waste of time. On all the 8,000 still to this day, apart from Everest, there are major features that haven't been attempted. I mean, features that really do catch the eye and draw you to them. You know, big buttresses and interesting, intricate faces with lines of weakness going up them. The way I suddenly went to Everest was simply because Don Williams rang me up one morning and asked me if I wanted to go. So I said yes, when we're going, because I was going in 3 weeks. I got to look sharp, and it was of course to the sharp end of the mountain, to the southwest face. We set off along the bit of rope and left it, and immediately the whole thing had quite a different feel to it. I mean, just suddenly we were cut off. There's just Doug and myself swinging leads, getting further and further from that rope. I'm more and more interested in what we were doing, more and more absorbed in the next step. For hour after hour, we'd just be, well, I was hardly aware of him, never mind everyone back home. It was just completely there in the moment after moment, all day with this calm prescience, actually, that we were going to make it. But it was that wonderful feeling you get when you are suddenly out on a limb going for it, and you just put your trust in the lap of the gods, really. And yeah, it's very exhilarating. And we got it right. We've been patient, waited our time. Weather was reasonable. Snow wasn't that good, but it got better higher up. And we were out looking out for each other and supportive of each other all the way. So it all came together. That's what made it a great climb, really, that yeah, everything was right on the day. I was just up on Bidian last week, actually, out of Glen Coe, and telling my friends who I was with that when I was 19, Christmas Eve, we got to the top of Bidian, hit by a storm, and the storm just got worse and worse, and in the end we had to spend the night on the summit. So I made something like a car bonnet, got legs into that, and then kept going out to get more snow and gather it around, and eventually put a sort of dome above us. Sat on the rope and in this little igloo for 14 hours. It was the same night that four lads were killed on Ben Nevis. Same storm hit them. So, I mean, it's experiences like that that gave me the confidence, and Dougal, I'm sure, to not think too badly about having an unplanned bivouac near the summit of Everest. We're pretty mean in Scotland in winter. Well, that was a case of being too gung-ho. I stood at the bottom, I remember looking up at the summit, saying to myself, I'm going to get this body from here to there. I didn't say, even if it kills me, but sort of on those lines, which is really stupid. I mean, of course it very nearly did kill me, and Chris as well. You know, we were right up there at 24,000 feet, base camp probably about 12,000 feet, something like that. And so it was a long way to go, and quite complicated ground. So, I mean, I'm sure anyone who was daft enough to break the legs up there would have come to the same conclusions as I did. Yeah, first of all, realise there's new rules for winning, and then take it one day at a time. One feature at a time, a knob of rock, a pinnacle, whatever. Get there, then think about the next bit, because, I mean, really, to think about the whole thing was a bit mind-boggling. It was a long 8 days there, descending. But, I mean, people say, only you could have done it, which is nonsense. Yeah, we all want to get home.